essentially what you do is you've got a storyline, and then I get a storyboard artist. All the action beats are all I storyboard with a storyboard artist, Tom Southwell, who worked with me on Executive Decision. So everything is blocked out, what I want to see.
But in the case of action sequences, they're particularly crucial. From these, all departments get a full idea of what my ideas are and the scale, as well as the detail of these ideas. From these images, we can all decide how best to achieve it on film. It really involves every department. It's the art department, special effects department, camera department, lighting department. They're all involved in the practical details on how to get all this on film.
I needed an aircraft crash that had a bunch of different things happening, not just one crash.
I conceived it in five separate acts. The first act being the decompression, where the prisoner tries to kill our fugitive Wesley Snipes, causing a hole to be blown in the side of the plane, necessitating an emergency landing. Act two is the landing itself, which is on a country road, and my idea was to make us, the audience, feel that everything's okay, that it's been a spectacular decompression sequence, but the pilots have been able to land the plane safely. So the prisoners on board and Tommy Lee Jones with the US Marshal Guards all have a sense of relief for a moment, and then to turn the tables on them and the audience by revealing that there's another danger, which is telegraph poles, and the pilot has no choice but to just plow through them. The wings manage to cut the telegraph poles down for a while, but aren't strong enough to sustain it. That sort of damage for long, and the wing is ripped off, creating explosions. So now we have, with inside the plane, a Dante's Inferno sequence of the flames being reflected and lighting the inside of the plane when the wing is ripped off and the exploding air fuel creates this fireball around the plane. That's the third act. The fourth act, what more can happen? Well, what more can happen is there's a curve in the road, which means that they're going to go through the barriers and over what turns out to be an embankment. So the fourth act is the plane plowing over this embankment, down the embankment and rolling into what turns out to be a river at the bottom of the embankment. And the fifth act is the plane upside down in the river, starting to sink, and Tommy Lee Jones taking control of the rescue attempt to get the prisoners out of the plane before it sinks and they all drown. The end of the fifth act being that the Wesley Snipes character escapes from the sinking plane, who then turns into the man he has to chase for the rest of the movie.
We have an airplane crash, and the airplane crash is really very exciting. I think we have come up with a scene that parallels the train sequence.
This was one of those locations that took us an enormous amount of effort to find. It had so many requirements that had to be fulfilled. We had to have a road where a plane could land and appear to have a safe landing, and then the road had to have a curve in it so that the plane went over the curve, and then we had to have an embankment plus a river. I think I spent about I don't know, maybe 3 months total looking for this particular location. It took us to 5 different states. And frequently when you put that much effort into finding a particular location, you come up with like, you know, 6 or 7 really good choices. This one was really the only one that fulfilled all the requirements, and we were really fortunate to find it. We did a lot of research with the National Transportation Safety Board. We looked at videotapes of plane crashes and a lot of stills to see exactly how a real airplane would break apart. And then we had to fit that into our storyline. In our story, the wings come off and the landing gear gets ripped off and the engines explode, but basically the fuselage is intact. Once we knew how it was going to go through the guardrail on the highway and what the landscape that it was going to tumble down was like and how it was going to land in the river, then we could do things like distress it with the guardrail bashing into the fuselage, how the wing gets ripped off, where the tail section got ripped off and where the explosions were. We had to line that on the highway so that it made logic for the aerial view. The interior of the plane to accommodate the action, which meant reversing the seats for the Marshals, putting the partitions up, giving it its whole general look, which is quite realistic. It wasn't taken over the top. And then making sure that what we did artistically was able to function physically with the requirements of the gimbal and the dunking the plane in the water. The decompression set is a particularly complicated set because it had to have the wall peel apart the way an airplane would actually break apart. And then 2 seats get sucked out, and then 1 character and then another character. So it was quite a complicated affair, and we had to have a set that was dedicated just to doing those shots.
And it was a real plane we used. We went to the aeronautical engineers and worked out that the structure of a plane is so strong that if you suspend it from the center, and you rather like a rotisserie, you can turn it. It's internally strong enough to be able to do that. So the engineers, very clever engineers, and the special effects guys, made this very elaborate gimbal, which enabled us to turn the aircraft, an entire aircraft, without its wings on, of course, 180 degrees.
Gimbal is a structure that we make to put a set in to make it tilt and shake and rotate and simulate the action of an actual airplane or a car moving.
It's a much simpler affair when you have to do an airplane that just sits there on a rocking gimbal, but when it has to be dunked in water and rotated 180 degrees and tilted every which way, suddenly it becomes a much bigger structural problem.
There's basically 2 joysticks, one to bring it up and down and tilt it, and the other one to rotate it. We can do it manually, or we can put it on a computer so it remembers each move.
It's a kind of a frightening thing because Lieutenant Gerard now has to take care of these prisoners who are shackled into their seats and shackled to the floor. They're upside down, hanging upside down. The whole thing is sinking. Water's coming up over their heads. He's trying to release them to save them, yet they're still prisoners. He's still got to control them. He opens the door. They dive out and they go to shore, and the plane just sinks under the water. In this case, it's not just the fuselage. It's literally practically the entire plane. It's sitting on a metal rig that has a bunch of kind of hollow, large hollow tubes running under it, and they're able to either pump air into the tubes or pump water. And so to raise or lower the plane, they can pump the appropriate amount of air or water, and they've got hydraulics on it that also raises it and lowers it, because we have to see the plane sink as Gerard is trying to get the prisoners out, and he's like the last one out, and right as he's leaving out, the whole front end just finally goes right under the water, and they've got it on pulleys and winches to the shore, and it was a trick.
Thank you.
This is our version of Boeing Aircraft Company. We have three different fuselages, 1/6 scale, Boeing 727-200. We've got various wings, we've got flaps, we've got landing gear. We've got electronics that get installed inside the fuselage. The first one that's down in the hole there, that one is for the flying, for when we had to bring it in to land. The second one that he's just buttoning up an access panel over here, that one is for where the tail breaks off and it rolls over upside down and goes into the river. And this is the one where the wings break off and do various things. Right here we have Dave, who's right now loading in explosives, and he's going to putting in the control systems for all the explosives, because there's, I don't know, 10 or 12 different charges that go inside, and they're all sequenced to go off at various times. This is a set of landing gear. When you see the plane land, you'll see all of this stuff compress, you'll see the wheels sponge, you'll see smoke come off of them. We use tricks to make the smoke come off of them, because we're not going 130 miles an hour, we're going about 25 miles an hour. The plane itself weighs about 1,000 pounds, 800 pounds, something like that, and we use all of the tricks of all of the experience of all of these wonderful people here to make this hopefully a magical thing. This is a 1/6 scale miniature. This 1,200 feet of road is really about a mile and a half long. So you have to think of it in those terms. In this case, even though what's really there are maples and oaks and all sorts of pine trees, and it's very pretty, we're using what's called a California small leaf pepper. And then Terry here is going along and she's putting a little bit of food coloring on the leaves so that it's not all one color, so that it looks like a natural forest. That's a 100 horsepower motor. And it spins this whole rig that tensions the cable, and the cable is actually a continuous loop, so that we have the pulling one and we have the pushing one, so that no matter which way we want the airplane to go, we can bring it back to us and take it back. And this can accelerate the airplane up to about 60 miles an hour. It's all computer controlled for safety, so that it's very repeatable. We can send the airplane down at 60 miles an hour and tell it to stop, and it'll stop within about 5 feet of where we ask it to. Mostly the difference of where it stops is because of cable stretch. So that we can do very spectacular things very close to camera with a completely controlled, safe, and exciting, so that everybody feels like they're a part of the sequence.
Oh man, the 4ml is great. And that's great too, right into that lens.